Hello students, here is Ankit Thukral from Edupedia World. Students, I have been discussing since prior sessions on international business, that is export trade and import trade, and India's position on international business. Today students, I will talk on import trade. Let me tell you, brief you about something about imports. Students, let me talk on basics of import. First, let me tell you what is import in simple words. Import is the purchase of foreign manufactured goods in the buyer's domestic market. Now the question is, why import is important? In any country, export as well as import helps to grow national economies and expands the global market. Some countries are rich in natural resources like Iran, Saudi Arabia in case of oil, while the same countries are poorer in other natural resources like metals, agricultural products, etc. Sometimes imports are important for businesses as the products are easily available and are cheaper overseas. Further, I may tell you that individual consumers sometimes are benefited from the locally produced products with the imported components. Often times, imported products provide a better price or more choices to consumers, which helps in increase of their standard of living. However, in nutshell, every country wants to be net exporter rather than net importers. So again, I am repeating, every country wants to be richer by exporting the goods rather than net importers. Because if you import more than export, more money is leaving the country than is coming in through export sales. Let me give you some data on exports and imports. India's total exports of merchandise has increased from 606 crores in 50-51 to rupees 2,93,367 crores in 2003-04. You see the difference of increase in case of exports from 1950-51 to 2003-04. Similarly, import of goods has also increased from 608 crores in 1950-51 to rupees 3,59,108 crores in 2003-04. That means the imports are more than the exports. Now students, let me tell you what is the definition of import trade. As you can see in the slide, import are the goods and services that are bought by residents, governments or businesses of a country but made outside of the country. So that means it is an import trade. Let's take an example, purchase of toys by an Indian toy dealer from a Chinese firm, and that means we are importing from Chinese. The domestic purchaser of goods is referred to as an importer, and the overseas based seller is referred to as an exporter. In case of toys, as given in the example, India is importer and whereas Chinese are exporter. Now students, let's go ahead and see what are the objectives of import trade. Let us go one by one. Number one is to speed up industrialization. Developing countries import scarce raw materials and capital goods and advanced technology required for rapid industrial development. Means industrialization, to speed up that, the import is required. Next objective is to meet consumer demand. The goods which are in demand but are not available in the country are imported. Goods in short supply are also imported to make up the deficiency. Now students, next is to improve, to overcome famine. What is famine? During famine, a country imports food grains and essential commodities to prevent starvation, drought, flood, earthquake and other natural calamities might create famine. Next objective is to improve standard of living. Imports enable consumers in the home country to enjoy a wide variety of products of high quality, which enhances their standard of living. Another objective is to ensure national defense. Countries like India import defense equipment for its armed forces. Such imports enable the country to ensure its territorial integrity. So, to make a country strong in defense, as since we are not the exporter even, we are the only importer in defense products. So, to ensure that its sovereignty and territorial integrity is there. Now, students, let's go ahead. After having the objectives of imported and why important, let's go ahead and see what is the process, how the import trade can be there. What are the procedures? Number one procedure is trade inquiry. The first stage in an important transaction is to conduct inquiry and collect information about the countries and firms which can export the required goods. Importer can get such information from trade directories, trade associations and organizations. After identifying a suitable exporter, the importer sends a trade inquiry. What trade inquiry contains? It is a written request from the importer to the exporter to provide information regarding the price, terms and conditions on which the exporter will be able to supply goods. In response to the inquiry, the exporter sends a reply in the form of a quotation that is known as a pro forma invoice. Now, second step is procurement of import license. In India, certain goods can be imported freely, while for others it is mandatory to obtain import license. Importer can consult EXIM, that means export import policy, to know whether license is needed or not. In case license is mandatory for the given goods, then the importer must obtain license from the licensing authority. Moreover, every importer is under an obligation to get registered with Directorate General Foreign Trade. That means, in short, we can say DGFT or RIELA, that is Regional Import Export Licensing Authority, and obtain an import export code number, that is IEC number. Why it is required? Is it IEC required to be mentioned on the most of the import documents? This is a process. Another is obtaining foreign exchange. After obtaining the license, as if required, every importer has to procure foreign exchange, as payment for imports has to be made in currency of exporting country. So mind it, it is required currency of exporting country only. In India, all foreign exchange transactions are regulated and sanctioned by the Exchange Control Department of Reserve Bank of India. To obtain the sanction for release of foreign currency, importer has to submit an application to a bank authorized by RBI along with a copy of import license. If the application meets approval of Reserve Bank of India, the necessary import amount of foreign exchange is released through the importer's bank. Next step is placing indent, or you can say placing an order. After obtaining the required foreign exchange, the importer places the order for goods to be imported. This order is known as indent. The order contains details regarding price, quantity, grade, packing and marking details and delivery instructions, etc. The next step is obtaining letter of credit. It is also a very essential part of import-export trade. Generally, the foreign exporter wants to be sure about the credit worthiness of the importer. For this purpose, importer obtains letter of credit from its own bank and forwards it to the exporter. Letter of credit is a guarantee issued by the importer's bank that it will honor payment up to a certain amount of export bills to the exporter's bank. However, it must be noted that importer's bank issues LC only when it is sure about the financial soundness of the importer. Another point is arranging for finance. The importer should make arrangement to pay in advance to the exporter. Advance payment saves the importer from heavy penalties which would have to be paid on imported goods lying uncleared at the port. Another step is shipment advice. After loading goods on the ship, the exporter dispatches the shipment advice to the importer. The shipment advice contains information regarding shipment of goods like invoice number, bill of lading or airways bill, etc. Another step is now retirement of documents. That means import documents. After shipment of goods, the exporter prepares and submits necessary documents to his banker such as commercial invoice, bill of lading, packing list, certificate of origin, marine insurance policies, etc. Now, what is bill of lading, certificate of origin? As already we have discussed in case of export trade. These documents are delivered to importer only when he accepts the bill of exchange, which is also sent along with the above mentioned documents. Further, I may tell you that bill of exchange can be of two types, document against site and document against acceptance. In case of document against site, documents are handed over only against payment, whereas in case of document against acceptance, documents are delivered to the importer when he accepts the bill of exchange and agreed to make payment on maturity. Now, next point is arrival of goods. When the goods arrive in the importer's country, the person in charge of the carrier, either ship or airways, informs the officer in charge at the dock or the airport about the arrival of goods. He provides the documents known as Import General Manifest. This document is that it contains the details of the imported goods. On the basis of this document, goods are unloaded from the carrier. Now, students, next point is in the process is custom clearance. How the clearance is done through customs and release of goods. In India, the delivery of imported goods can be taken only after custom clearance. Unless custom clearance is there, goods cannot be released. What are the steps in case of custom clearance? Steps in custom clearance, as you can see in the slide, number one is delivery order. When the ship arrives at the port of destination, the importer will either obtain endorsement of delivery on the back of bill of lading or delivery order from the shipping company. This order entitles the importer to take the delivery of goods. Another step is payment of dock charges. The importer is required to submit two copies of a duly filled in form known as application to import to the lending and shipping dues office. This office collects dock charges and gives back one copy of the application as a receipt known as port trust dues receipt. Now, another is bill of entry. The importer then fills in the form bill of entry in a triplicate for assessment of customs import duty. Complete details of the goods imported are to be declared in it. Another is payment of import duty. The importer is required to submit one copy of port trust dues receipt as given in case of payment of dock charges, two copies of bill of entries along with other required document to the custom authorities and make payment of import duty. Another is release order. After payment of import duty, the bill of entry has to be marked by the dock superintendent and an examiner is asked to physically examine the imported goods. The examiner gives his report on the bill of entry. This bill is then presented to the port authority and they issue the release order after receiving necessary charges. So these are the steps in case of customs clearance. Now, student, I may tell you that as custom clearance is a tedious process and requires number of formalities, importers generally appoint C&F agents who are well versed with such formalities. Now, students, let's go ahead and see what are the documents, what type of documents are used in case of import transactions. Let us go one by one. Number one is trade inquiry. Trade inquiry is a written request by the importer to the exporter to provide information regarding the price, terms and conditions on which the exporter will be able to supply goods. Number second is pro forma invoice. A pro forma invoice is a document that contains detailed information regarding price, quality, grade, size, weight and all other relevant conditions on which their export will take place. Another document is indent. What is indent? As we have seen in case of export also, it is a document in which the importer places order to the exporter for supply of requisite goods. It contains details regarding price, quantities, grade, packing and marking details, delivery instructions and mode of payments, etc. Another is shipment advice. Shipment advice is a document that the exporter sends to the importer informing him that the shipment of goods has been made. What information it provides? It provides information regarding shipment of goods like invoice number, bill of lading or airways bill, etc. Another document used is bill of entry. What is bill of entry? It is a document prepared by the importer which shows the detail of goods imported and is used by custom authorities for determining import duty. So bill of entry is an important document as it helps in determining the import duty. It has to be triplicate and is to be submitted to the customs office. Another is site draft. It is a type of bill of exchange in which the drawer, that is exporter, instructs the bank to hand over the relevant document to the importer only against payment. Another is usance draft. What is this? It is a type of bill of exchange again in which the drawer, that is exporter, instructs the bank to hand over the relevant document to the importer only against acceptance of bill of exchange. So it differs from the site draft. Site draft documents to the importer only against payment, whereas in case of usance draft, against acceptance of the bill of exchange. Another is import general manifest. It is a document that contains the details of the imported good. On the basis of this document, goods are unloaded from the carrier. Unless this is there, goods cannot be unloaded. Another is dock challan. What is dock challan? Dock charges are to be paid when all the formalities of the customs are completed, as we have seen in case of custom clearance. Just now, dock challan is a document prepared by importer or his C&F agent which specifies the amount of dock dues. So students, these are all the documents normally used in case of importing the goods. As again, I can say that it is a complicated process, but importer must be aware of all these processes and import transactions, documents, etc. As customs clearance normally is a tedious process, as I have said right now, and requires number of formalities, importers generally appoint C&F agent who are well versed and experienced with such formalities and compliance. So that's all. Let us wind up today for this session and let us go in the next session on the other things. Thank you. Bye-bye.